Red Brick Media. High quality CDs, DVDs, lectures, khutbah, conferences and Quran recitations. All revenue generated supports our dawah work, supported by visiting our store. You can now purchase directly from our site, www.redbrickmedia.co.uk. غرباء غرباء
غرباء غرباء. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام الأتمان الأكملان على خير خلق الله أجمعين، وعلى آله وصحبه ومن سار على سبيله ونهجه واستنى بسنته واهتدى بهديه إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا، أما بعد. Inshallah, we're going to start this session with recitation of the Quran with Brother Usama. Jazakallah khair.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm going to read it with the verse. Okay. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أتى أمر الله فلا تستعجلوه سبحانه وتعالى عما يشركون. ينزل الملائكة بالروح من أمره على من يشاء من عباده ينزل الملائكة بالروح من أمره على من يشاء من عباده أن أنذروا أنه لا إله إلا أنا فاتقون. خلق السماوات والأرض بالحق تعالى عما يشركون. خلق الإنسان من نطفة فإذا هو خصيم مبين. والأنعام خلقها لكم فيها دفء ومنافع ومنها تأكلون. ولكم فيها جمال حين تريحون وحين تسرحون. وتحمل أثقالكم إلى بلد لم تكونوا بالغيه إلا بشق الأنفس إن ربكم لرؤوف رحيم. إن ربكم لرؤوف رحيم. والخيل والبغال والحمير لتركبوها وزينة ويخلق ما لا تعلمون. وعلى الله قصد السبيل ومنها جائر ولو شاء لهداكم أجمعين. هو الذي أنزل من السماء ماء لكم منه شراب ومنه شجر فيه تسيمون. ينبت لكم به الزرع والزيتون والنخيل والأعناب ومن كل الثمرات إن في ذلك لآية لقوم يتفكرون.
So inshallah we're going to begin today's final session with our Sheikh Faisal Al-Jasim from Kuwait. I think from what I understand early on it was announced that Sheikh Saleh Sadlan would initially be doing this session. The Sheikh, because he's already had two very long sessions today, which included Q&A, the Sheikh's actually quite tired, so he sends his apologies. So inshallah, we have Sheikh Faisal with us today, and Sheikh Saleh Sadlan will be back with us again tomorrow morning, inshallah, or tomorrow after Dhuhr, inshallah ta'ala. So with that, inshallah, I'm going to hand over the mic to Sheikh Faisal to begin.
Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, wa salatu wa salamu ala ashraf al-anbiya wa mursaleen, nabiyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Kana min al-muftarad أن يكون معنا شيخ صالح سدلان في هذه المحاضرة، لكن الشيخ كما ذكر اعتذر لتعبه، والقاعدة أنه إذا تعذر استعمال ماء صرنا إلى التيمم، فأنتم الآن في حالة التيمم.
So the Sheikh, mashallah, began حفظه الله in a very humble way, in a very light-hearted manner. He said that the Sheikh, Sheikh صالح سدلان حفظه الله, sends his apologies and he excuses himself because he is very tired. And the established principle in Islam is that when you don't have any water, you do tayammum. So now we are making tayammum.
حديثنا إن شاء الله في هذه الليلة كما هو معلن عنه فيما يتعلق بالخلاف أو أوجه من الخلاف الواقع بين العلماء. وقد ذكرنا في الدرس الماضي بأن من الخلاف ما هو مقبول سائغ ومن الخلاف ما هو مردود. أما الخلاف المقبول فقد ذكرنا أو الخلاف المردود فقد ذكرنا هو الخلاف في أصول أهل السنة والجماعة في قواعدهم في فهم الدين والعمل به والدعوة إليه في الأصول الكلية في الاعتقاد كمسائلهم في الإيمان والأسماء والصفات والقدر والأمر المعروف والنهي عن المنكر والدعوة والموقف من العلماء والموقف من أهل البدع وما شابه ذلك من هذه الأصول التي قد ذكرها العلماء رحمهم الله في كتب الأصول المطولة والمتوسطة والمختصرة. وأصل الأصول هنا كتب العقائد كتب السنة كتب العقائد. وأما المسائل التي يسع فيها الخلاف فهي كثيرة.
So the Shaykh Hafidhahullah, he began and he said that we're going to speak today about the difference of opinion that occurs amongst the scholars or some of the aspects that pertain to this chapter and to this issue. And he said that we mentioned earlier on today that there are two types of differences. One type which is accepted and another type which is rejected. So as for the type which is rejected, it is any difference of opinion in those matters which are considered to be the fundamentals and the principles of this religion. Anything to do with our belief, with our aqidah, with our faith, anything to do with the names and the attributes of Allah, anything to do with matters of pre-decree, anything to do with ordering the good, forbidding the evil, anything to do with the way we deal with the people of innovation, and so on and so forth. All of these have been mentioned in the great books of Aqidah, those books that deal with these issues. The scholars have mentioned them. So any difference of opinion in these fundamental issues is not accepted, but it is rejected. As for the type of difference which is accepted, then it falls into many, many chapters, and there are many examples of this.
والاختلاف كما ذكرنا أمر فطري فطر الله جل وعلا العباد على الخلاف كما قال جل وعلا ولا يزالون مختلفين إلا من رحم ربك فاستثنى الله جل وعلا أهل الرحمة من الخلاف فدل على أن من صفة أهل الرحمة الاجتماع والمراد بالاجتماع الاجتماع على هذا الدين الذي جاء به النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ولله جل وعلا حكم كثيرة في هذا الخلاف الواقع بين الناس فمنها تمايز أهل الحق والباطل ومنها ظهور كثير مما يحبه الله جل وعلا من العبادات كالأمر المعروف والنهي عن المنكر والصبر على ذات الله والدعوة إليه وما شابه ذلك فهذه أمور محبوبة لا يمكن أن تقع إلا أن يقدر الله عز وجل الخلاف.
So the Sheikh said that as we mentioned also earlier on today that differences of opinion is something which is natural. It is something which Allah Azza wa Jal has created within our nature that we will differ over certain things. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says and mentions in the Qur'an, and they will continue to differ except for those from whom Allah Azza wa Jal has His mercy upon. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that the nature of people is that they will differ. But from the mercy of Allah is when people gather together and they unite upon something. And then the Shaykh Maintan Salamahullah, he said that there are many, many wisdoms behind these types of difference of opinion. So from them is that, so that the people will know and be able to differentiate the people of truth from the people of falsehood. Also along with this, it is so that there can be many different types of actions, many different acts that you can come closer to Allah Azza wa Jal with due to these differences. So for example, that you order the good, that you forbid the evil, that you call to the path of Allah, that you remain firm and you have patience upon this, all of this is from the wisdoms of these differences of opinion.
والخلاف كما ذكرنا وقد ذكرنا الميزان والضابط في معرفة ما يسوق مما لا يسوق وهو النظر في أفعال السلف رحمهم الله فكل ما ساغ عند السلف الخلاف فيه وتعايشوا معه فهو مما يسوغ عندنا وكل ما رفضوه من الخلاف وردوه وأنكروا على قائله وفاعله وربما عدوه من أهل البدع فإنه لا يسع الخلاف فيه فهذا هو الضابط وهذا هو الأصل الذي يستند عليه أهل السنة والجماعة وهو أنهم يسيرون في كل أمور دينهم ومنها الدعوة ومنها الأمر المعروف والنهي عن المنكر على الوفق المنهج الذي سار عليه الصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنه.
So the Sheikh said that we also mentioned earlier on today the scale or the measuring stick or what we use to define and differentiate what types of differences are allowed and what types of differences are not allowed and not accepted. And he said that measuring stick, that scale, is that we look at the actions of our pious predecessors, from the Salaf, from the companions and those who followed them in righteousness. So everything that they allow differences in, everything which they accepted as a legitimate difference of opinion, then we also accept this. But anything which they rejected, any type of difference of opinion which they rejected, and maybe they even went to the level of saying that this is an innovation, then it is also something which we reject as well. And this is a principle of the people of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the people of Hadith, that they base all of this upon what the companions and those who follow them upon righteousness did.
Wal khilaf al maqbool wal mardood. ليس كما يقول بعض الناس بين الخلافة في الأصول والأمور العقدية هذا لا خلاف فيه ولا يقبل فيه الخلاف وأن المسائل الفقهية يقبل فيها الخلافة هذا ليس بضابط صحيح كما ذكر ذلك شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله ليس هناك ضابط بل هناك المسائل التي تعد المسائل الاعتقاد مما اختلف فيها الصحابة كرؤية النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ربه في المعراج وكسماع الأموات وكتعذيب الميت بكاء أهله عليه وما شابه ذلك ما جرى بين الصحابة النزاع فيه فهذا مع أنها مسائل عقدية وليست مسائل فقهية ومع ذلك ساغ فيها الخلاف فالشاهد أن ليس هناك ضابط نقول كل ما كان من قبيل ما يعتقده الإنسان فالخلاف فيه غير مقبول وكل ما كان قبيل فقهي غير مقبول ويدل على أن بعض الخلاف الفقهي غير مقبول ولو كانت مسألة فقهية مدرسة أهل الرأي التي ظهرت في العراق قد ذكرنا أن أهل الرأي المراد بهم من يقدمون الرأي على السنة من يقدمون الرأي والقياس على السنة فيأتي الحديث الصحيح لهم فيقولون هذا الحديث يخالف القياس فلا نقول به كما كان في قصة السلم وما شابه ذلك قالوا السلم هو أن يشتري إنسان شيء مؤجل بثمن حاضر يشتري شيء مؤجل بثمن حاضر قالوا هذا خلاف القياس لماذا؟ قال لأنه بيع معدوم وقد نهى النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام عن بيع المعدوم فهذا خلاف القياس ولم يعملوا به هؤلاء أهل الرأي مع أن هذه مسائل فقهية لكن أهل السنة والجماعة ردوا هؤلاء وأنكروا عليه وذلك عقد كثير من أهل العلم في كتب السنة كتبا في الرد على أهل الرأي وذكروا ذلك في كتب المعتقد كما عقد عبد الله بن الإمام أحمد رحمه الله في كتاب السنة فصلا في الرد على أهل الرأي وعقد كذلك حرب الكرماني في مسائله في باب المعتقد فصلا في الرد على أهل الرأي وقد أنكروا على ذلك فالشاهد أن المسألة قد تكون مسألة فقهية ومع ذلك لا يسع الخلاف فيها وقد تكون مسألة عقدية ومع ذلك يسع الخلاف فيها ما هو الضابط؟ الضابط ما وسع السلف وسعنا وما لم يسع السلف لم يسعنا
So the Sheikh said that when we talk about the differences of opinion that are accepted or rejected then it is not as some people say, that we are only allowed to have differences of opinion in matters of fiqh, in matters of law. But when it comes to matters of belief, matters of aqidah, then there is no difference of opinion in this. This is an incorrect scale to use, and it is an incorrect measuring stick to apply, as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah mentioned. And the Shaykh gave some examples of this, of how the companions would differ over some matters of aqidah as well. And so they would have this difference of opinion amongst themselves. From that is that they differed as to whether or not the Prophet ﷺ saw Allah Azza wa Jal when he went through the night journey and he ascended to the heavens, Isra and Mi'raj. Did he see the Prophet ﷺ or not? This was a difference of opinion on a matter of aqidah amongst them. Likewise, they would differ as to whether the dead in their graves can hear the living. This was something which they differed upon. A third example of this is that they also differed that when a person comes to a grave and he cries or he wails, will those within the grave, will they be punished because of this wailing that their relatives or their friends do whilst they are alive? This is something which they differed in. So this is not a correct measuring scale to use, to say everything in aqidah has no difference of opinion. At the same time, we can also say that those things or those issues that relate to fiqh, it is also not correct to say that everything within them, there is a difference of opinion, that we can accept differences of opinion in every single one of those issues. And the Shaykh gave the example of the people who take intellect and analogy over the hadith and over the sunnah. As the Shaykh said, he mentioned earlier on today as well. These people known as Ahlul Ra'i, the people of analogy, the people who use their intellect over the book and the sunnah, the scholars have said that what they say is rejected, or some of what they say is rejected, so, and the Shaykh gave an example of this. For example, it is allowed for a person to come and to buy something now, but to pay for it later. But these people rejected it based upon their own analogy. So this is something which is, even though this is a difference of opinion, it is a difference of opinion which is rejected because there is a clear hadith which supports this. And this is why the Shaykh said that the scholars of the Sunnah have written in their works of Aqeedah, they have chapters which deal with this issue, refuting these people who hold this methodology of precedence of analogy over the hadith and sunnah. And the example of this is the son of Imam Ahmad, Abdullah ibn Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. He has a chapter in his book of Aqeedah on this, as well as other than him. So the point here is that the measuring scale is not whether the issue is an issue of Aqeedah or an issue of fiqh, but rather the measuring scale is that we look at what the Salaf did. That which they allowed differences in, we accept. That which they did not allow differences in, we reject.
وعلى هذا فنقول بعبارة أخرى كل ما خالف الإجماع أو النص فهو مردود. كل ما خالف الإجماع أو النص فهو خلاف مردود. وقد ذكرنا أمثلة على الأصول التي اتفق عليها أهل السنة والجماعة وأجمع عليها. فقد ذكرنا ونضرب على ذلك مثالا على سبيل التذكير مسألة رؤية الله جل وعلا يوم القيامة للمؤمنين، هذا مسألة مجمع عليها، مع أنهم قد اختلفوا في رؤية النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام لربه في المعراج. فنقول مسألة الرؤية، رؤية المؤمنين لربهم يوم القيامة مسألة مجمع عليها، لا يقبل فيها الخلاف. مسألة كما ذكرنا مسألة الجهاد، وأن الجهاد منوط بالأئمة وبالحكام وبالسلاطين، هم الذين يرفعون الراية، وأن ليس لأحد أن يأمر بالجهاد أو أن يرفع راية الجهاد دون الأئمة، كما هي في مسألة الحدود. فهذه مسألة مجمع عليها بأن الحدود وبأن الجهاد منوط بالأئمة. ولذلك الإمام أحمد رحمه الله لما ذكروا له أن بعض أهل الكوفة أو بعض أهل الشام ينكرون خلافة علي بن أبي طالب، ويقول علي بن أبي طالب لم يكن خليفة في عهده للخلاف الذي وقع، غضب الإمام أحمد قال كيف؟ كان علي بن أبي طالب يقضي بين الناس ويقيم الحدود ويسمى بأمير المؤمنين في محضر الصحابة. فاستدل على إقامة علي بن أبي طالب للحدود على أنه الخليفة بإجماع الصحابة. وعلى هذا فهذا يدل على ماذا؟ على أن هذه المسائل من المسائل مجمع عليها. وعلى هذا فكل ما خالف الإجماع سواء كان فيما يتعلق في العقيدة أو ما يتعلق في الفقه أو خالف النص فإنه خلاف مردود، وهذا الذي رده الصحابة رضي الله عنهم ورده السلف.
So the Sheikh then continued and he said that it is possible to elaborate this in another way or in another sentence, and that is that we say that everything which goes against or contradicts the ijma of the Muslims or a clear text, then there is something which we refuse and we reject as a difference of opinion. Everything which contradicts the ijma, the consensus of the scholars or a text, it is something which we will refuse and refute. And the Shaykh gave a number of examples of this to do with matters of Aqeedah. He said, for example, the scholars have agreed there is consensus and ijma' that the people will see their Lord Allah Azza wa Jal on the Day of Judgment. Even though they differed as to whether or not the Prophet ﷺ saw Allah when he went for the Isra and Mi'raj, the scholars have agreed that on Yawm al-Qiyamah the believers will see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is ijma', it is consensus and agreement of the scholars. So now for someone to come and differentiate here, or to go against this, or to have another opinion, this is a difference of opinion which will be rejected. Likewise, another example is that jihad, or establishing the hudud, the legal boundaries of Islam and the capital punishment and so on and so forth, all of this is to do with the Muslim leaders. They are the ones who establish this. And it is not allowed for any normal person or any average or general person from the population to come and establish these types of principles. Rather, they are only done with the rulers. And this is also something upon which there is agreement. And he gave the example of the story of Imam Ahmad rahimahullah. It was said to him that the people of Sham, they dispute the khilaf of Ali. They don't agree that Ali radiallahu anhu was the khalifa. So when they mentioned this to Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he became very angry. And he said, how is it possible that they can make such a claim? For Ali radiallahu anhu used to judge between the people, and he used to establish the punishments upon them, and he used to be called Amir al-Mu'mineen, leader of the believers. And all of this was done in the presence of the companions radiallahu anhum during their lifetimes. So the Shaykh is saying, see how Imam Ahmad here has used the issue of establishing the punishments as a dalil, or as an evidence that he was the leader of the Muslims, showing that this is only something which can be done with their leadership and under their leadership. So this is the type of This is the type of disagreement or difference of opinion which is rejected in Islam.
وعلى هذا إذا خالف أحد ولو كان من العلماء ولو كان في عهد السلف خالف مسألة مجمعا عليها أو مسألة منصوصا عليها فإن خلافه غير معتبر. وعلى هذا سار الصحابة رضي الله عنهم، ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما وهو ترجمان القرآن وحبر القرآن وعالم الأمة، كان يرى بأجواز نكاح المتعة لأنه لم يبلغه الحديث، والحديث قد ثبت وأجمعت على ذلك الأمة. ماذا قال له عبد الله بن الزبير رضي الله تعالى عنه لما كان خليفة؟ قال له عبد الله بن الزبير: لو فعلتها يا ابن عباس لرجمتك. لم يقل هذا ابن عباس وخلافه ساغ، لا، لأن المسألة منصوص عليها وكل ما فيه نص فإنه لا يقبل الخلاف. لما قال عبد الله بن عباس رضي الله عنهما يأمر الناس بحج التمتع، أن يحجوا حج التمتع، أن يجمع بين العمرة والحج في سفرة واحدة، فعارضه من عارضه وقالوا إن أبا بكر وعمر ينهان عن ذلك ولم يفعل ذلك، فغضب، قال: أقول لكم قال رسول الله، تكاد تنزل عليكم حجارة من السماء، أقول لكم قال رسول الله وتقولون قال أبو بكر وعمر، أي لا يقبل. لماذا؟ ولو كان الذي قال بالقول أبو بكر وعمر وهم من هما في جلالتهما. لماذا؟ لأن المسألة منصوص عليها. وعلى هذا فما فيه نص فإنه لا يمكن أن نقول والله خالف فلان وخالف فلان، لا عبرة ولا عبرة لقول أحد كائنا من كان في مخالفة النص والإجماع.
So the Shaykh then continued and he said, and this is something that which we also see and notice from the scholars of the past, from the Salaf, that if someone went against the consensus of the scholars or a clear text, whoever he was, even if he was one of the companions or one of the great scholars of Islam, then his opinion would also be rejected, because we have this principle which is firmly established. His opinion would not be given any due consideration. And the Shaykh gave a couple of examples on this. The first one was one of the opinions of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, the great companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the interpreter of the Quran, one of the greatest and most knowledgeable of the companions radiallahu anhuma. He would hold the opinion that it was allowed, it was permissible to have mut'a marriage. And mut'a marriage is when the two parties agree upon divorce before the marriage, that they will get married and then eventually they will go into divorce. He thought that this was something which was allowed and permissible, even though there are ahadith that mention that it is strictly prohibited in Islam. But this was the opinion that he held. But the companions never accepted this from him, because it was an opinion which clearly went against an established text. And this is why Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anh, he would say to Ibn Abbas during his khilafah, that, oh Ibn Abbas, if you were to go ahead and perform such a nikah, I would then stone you to death. Because his opinion, even though it was his opinion, they never said that because he's Ibn Abbas, let's go and accept his opinion. No, there's an established text here, there's a consensus of the companions, so it was rejected. Likewise, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he would order the people and encourage them to perform the Hajj of Tamattu'. And the Hajj of Tamattu' is where you perform Hajj and Umrah in one journey with two separate ihrams. So some of the companions or some of the people, they came and they said that Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhuma, they would forbid us from this. So Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma became angry. And he said that I fear that stones will come from the heavens and they will come and strike you and hit you and destroy you. How can you tell me that Abu Bakr and Umar say something, and when I say to you that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has allowed something else? So the point is here that Ibn Abbas is saying this about who? About the likes of Abu Bakr and Umar, the greatest of the companions. But when we have something which is firmly established in the Sunnah, when we have a consensus of the Ummah, then this is something which we don't pay any attention to.
ومما أجمع عليه للسنة واتفقت عليه وتظاهرت عليه الأحاديث المنع من الخروج على أئمة الجور والظلم، ولو ظهر منهم من الظلم ما ظهر إلا أن وقعوا في الكفر البين المجمع عليه. هذا أمر مجمع عليه، والأحاديث في ذلك مستفيضة، وجاءت في النهي عن الخروج والأمر بالصبر وما شابه ذلك مما تواتر عن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام. وقد خالف بعض العلماء، بعض السلف قد خالف في ذلك لشبهة أو لعدم بلوغ النص وما شابه ذلك، كما خالف عبد الرحمن بن أبي ليلى وسعيد بن جبير والشعبي في خروجه مع الحجاج في فتنة ابن الأشعث في السنة 80 للهجرة. فهل يمكن لأحد أن يحتج بأفعال هؤلاء وقد جاءت النصوص المتضافرة في المنع عن الخروج على أئمة الجور لفعل هؤلاء؟ أبدا. ولذلك أفعال هؤلاء لا تخرم الإجماع أصلا، ولا يحتج بها. هؤلاء هم أفاضل الناس. لماذا؟ لثبوت النص وثبوت الإجماع. ولذلك لما قيل للإمام أحمد رحمه الله وأتاه رجل يحتج بجواز الخروج على أئمة الظلم والجور وما شابه ذلك محتجا بخروج كما يزعم هو بخروج عبد الله بن الزبير وعدم مبايعه ليزيد، فغضب الإمام أحمد، قال ذاك في كتابه إذا كنتم تنهون عن خروج هذا عبد الله بن الزبير خرج. فغضب الإمام أحمد غضبا شديدا وقال هذا يحتج لأهل البدع بما لا يحسنوه، وغضب كيف يؤتى بقول ولو كان صحابيا مخالفا للنص لا يقدم قول أحد كائن من كان على النص. فإذا ثبت الإجماع أو ثبت النص فلا قول لأحد. وعلى هذا فلا يمكن اليوم أن نأتي لأقوال مخالفة الإجماع والنص ونقبلها بحكم أنها آراء وأنها اجتهادات وأنها ما شبهها. إذا كانت أقاويل الصحابة إذا خالفت النص لم تقبل، وقال ابن عباس تكاد تنزل عليكم حجارة من السماء لما عرضوه بقول أبي بكر وعمر، فكيف بمن هو دون أبي بكر وعمر؟ نحن متعبدون بأن نتبع النصوص وأن نسير على نهج السلف رحمهم الله فيما أجمعوا فيه.
So the Sheikh said that also from the examples of this ijma', the consensus that these scholars have is the issue of revolting and rebelling against the rulers. And that it is something which is prohibited even if those rulers happen to be oppressive and transgressive and they are people of injustice. It is not allowed until you see a clear form of disbelief which the scholars attest to and they agree to, and it is something which is clear. And this is something rather that the Prophet ﷺ would order us, and you'll find this in many ahadith, the Prophet ﷺ would order the people to have patience. And he would order them not to revolt against these rulers. And this is something which is mutawatir, it is very, very well known and very, very well reported. Even though there are some of the scholars of the past who actually disagreed with this, either because they had no knowledge of this hadith, or for whatever reason, they disagreed with this. And the Shaykh gave a couple of examples, the likes of Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Layla and Sa'id ibn Jubayr, others and others from amongst them, some of the great scholars of Islam, during the time of Hajjaj, they revolted against him. And so they held the opinion that it was allowed. But because we have a clear text, because we have this consensus in place, what they did, we say that it is something which they did and they had no knowledge of this hadith. But we don't accept it, and it doesn't go and contradict that ijma' because we have these clear texts in place. And this is why it is not possible then to come and to use these people as examples or proofs or evidences. We can't say because so-and-so did this, this is my proof and this is why I am doing it. This is his opinion and I want to follow it. No, there is a consensus in place. There are clear established texts in place. And this is why when one of them came to Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, and he was saying and he was using as an evidence for the permissibility of revolting against the rulers, he was using the incident of Abdullah ibn Zubayr radiallahu anhuma when he went and revolted, or he didn't give the pledge of allegiance to Yazid. And so he thought that this was a valid evidence to use in this issue. So Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, he became very, very angry. And he said that this man, he has come with what even the people of innovation have not come with, something which even they do not say. And so the point of this is that it is not possible, even though these are great companions, great scholars of Islam, because they go against an established text, because their opinion contradicts an established text or consensus, we don't follow their opinions. Like Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma said about the likes of Abu Bakr and Umar, and who is there within the Ummah that is better than these two individuals? No one. But even so, Ibn Abbas said that the stones will come and they will destroy you because you go against the text of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم.
ومن ذلك مثلا أن بعض أهل الكوفة رأى أن الخمر لا يحرم شربها إلا إذا كانت من العنب، وأن الخمر لا تكون إلا من العنب. أما ما ليس من العنب كالخمر المصنوع من التمر أو العسل أو الحنطة أو غير ذلك فهذه لا تحرم ولو كانت مسكرة إلا إذا شرب الإنسان إلى حد الإسكار. يعني لو قيل أن هذا خمر من التمر لو شربت نصفه لا تسكر، لو شربته كله تسكر. يقولون بعض هؤلاء أهل الكوفة كأحمد بن سليمان وغيرهم أنك يحل لك أن تشرب منه ما لم يصل بك إلى حد الإسكار، والمحرم أن تشرب ما يوصلك الإسكار. أما إذا كان من العنب فيحرم قليل وكثير. ولا شك أن هذا القول قد قال به أئمة كأحمد بن سليمان وأبي حنيف وغيرهم، وهم أئمة من أئمة أهل العلم. لكنها أقوال مخالفة للنص ومخالفة للإجماع السابق. ولذلك أجمع العلماء على أن من شرب الخمرة التي يسكر كثيرها ولو كانت من التمر أو من غيرها أنه يقام عليه الحد، ولا يقبل أن يقول والله أنا اتبعت فلان وفلان. لماذا؟ لأن هذا القول وإن قال به من قاله فإنه مخالف للنص الظاهر.
The Sheikh then gave another example and he said that some of the scholars of Kufa in Iraq, they held the opinion that the wine that is prohibited in Islam is the wine that is taken from grapes. As for anything, any type of wine or any type of spirit drink which is made from other than grapes, such as that which is made from dates or from honey or from barley, then it is allowed to drink so long as it doesn't make you intoxicated. So the Sheikh gave the example is if we have that jug and we said that there was something, some kind of wine that was made from dates, for example. And if you drank half of it, you wouldn't become intoxicated, you wouldn't become drunk. But if you drank all of it, you would become drunk. Then those scholars say that you are allowed to drink half of it or whatever amount, so long as you don't become drunk. When you become drunk, then it's haram. But anything underneath that, it's allowed. As for the wine of grapes, then it is all prohibited, whether it is a small amount or a great amount. And the Sheikh said that this was the opinion of some of the great scholars of Kufa, the likes of Hamad ibn Sulaiman rahimahullah, and many of the scholars of Kufa. This was the opinion that they held. But even so, it goes against the established texts of the Sunnah. It goes against the consensus that the scholars have, the agreement that is in place amongst the scholars of Islam, even though these individuals in their own right, in their own status, are great scholars of Islam as well. And this is why the scholars say that if a person was to drink the wine of honey or of dates or anything else, even if it was just a small amount, you would still establish the punishment upon him. You would still lash him. And it wouldn't be acceptable for him to come and use as an excuse that so-and-so has this opinion, or this is the madhab of so-and-so. Why? Because we have a clear text and we have this consensus in place.
وَأَمَّا الْمَسَائِلَ الَّتِي لَيْسَ فِيهَا نَصٌ وَلَا إِجْمَاعٌ إِمَّا أَنْ لَا يَكُونَ فِيهَا حَدِيثٌ أو تكون فيها حديث ربما ظاهره التعارض، أو جاءت بها حديث ليست نصوصاً، أو بعض الأحاديث التي طرقها فيها شيء من الكلام فيصححها بعضهم ويضعفها بعضهم، فهذه مما ساغ فيها الخلاف. وهذه أمور كثيرة مبثوثة في كتب العلماء في مسائل فقهية في أبواب الطهارة والصلاة وغيرها كثير. كما مسألة مس الذكر هل ينقض الوضوء ولا ما ينقض الوضوء؟ من منهم يقول ينقض الوضوء لأن النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام قال من مس ذكره فليتوضأ، ومنهم من يقول لا ينقض لحديث طلق قال الرجل يمس ذكره الوضوء عليه وضوء، يمس ذكره في الصلاة عليه وضوء قال لا، أو قراءة القرآن للحائض، أو نقض الطهارة من أكل لحم الإبل، أو ما شابه ذلك مما يختلف فيه العلماء مما ليس فيه نص، وقد يأتي ربما يأتي حديث قد يختلفون في ظاهره، فهذا ما يسوغ فيه الخلاف. والمسائل المذكورة في هذا كثيرة، ولا أظنها تخفى على أحد منكم من له اطلاع على كتب الفقه.
So the Sheikh said, then as for that type of difference of opinion which is accepted, it is where we don't have this consensus in place, or where there is not a clear established authentic hadith. So for example, there may be a hadith but it is not clear what it is referring to, or a hadith where the scholars differ over its authenticity. Some of them say it is sahih, others say it is weak. So when it comes to this kind of affair or this kind of issue, this is where we accept the difference of opinion that takes place. And there are so many examples, thousands of different issues that this can be applied upon, and all of these are mentioned in the books of fiqh. And the Sheikh just gave a couple of examples. He said, for example, if someone was to touch their private part, would this break their wudu? There is a difference of opinion over this, because there is a hadith where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned that whosoever touches his private parts, then let him make wudu. But in another hadith, a man came and he said, O Messenger of Allah, if I was to touch my private parts, would it break my wudu? And he said, no. So this is somewhere now where there is a legitimate difference of opinion, because the text is not clear, it is not established. Also, for example, whether a woman who is upon her monthly period, whether she is allowed to recite the Quran, an issue of difference of opinion. Likewise, for someone who eats the meat of camel meat, does it break his wudu? An issue of difference of opinion. And the Sheikh said that there are thousands literally of different masail, different issues that are examples of this, and most of you will probably know them, or some of them if you have studied fiqh.
ولذلك يقول الناظم يقول في نظمه ليس كل خلاف معتبر بل ما فيه حظ من النظر. ليس كل خلاف معتبر والله خالف فيه فلان، لا، لكن الخلاف المعتبر هو الذي فيه حظ من النظر، الذي يكون فيه حظ من دليل، حظ من آية، حظ من آراء بعض الصحابة مع عدم مخالفة لا نص ولا إجماع. هذه مسألة. المسألة المهمة أيضا أن نعرف بأن عامة مسائل الدين العقدية والفقهية لا سيما العقدية منها أنها منصوص عليها ومجمع عليها، ولذلك مسائل النص والإجماع أكثر بكثير من مسائل الخلاف، خلافا لما يقوله بعض الناس، وهذا خطأ، أن المسائل الخلاف أكثر من مسائل الإجماع، خطأ. ولنضرب على ذلك مثالا، الصلاة أجمع العلماء على وجوب الصلاة، وأجمعوا على أنها خمس صلوات، وأجمعوا أن الفجر ركعتين، وأن الظهر أربع، والعصر أربع، والعشاء أربع، والمغرب ثلاث، وأجمعوا على أيش ركنية تكبيرة الإحرام والركوع والسجود والسجدة بالسجدتين والتشهد، كل هذا، وأجمعوا على اشتراط الطهارة واشتراط استقبال القبلة واشتراط ستر العورة ودخول الوقت، كل ذلك مما أجمع عليه، لكنهم اختلفوا في بعض الصور. إذن لب الدين وأساسه مجمع عليه، الزكاة أجمعوا على أن على وجوب الزكاة، وعلى أن الزكاة تجب في الذهب والفضة وما يقوم مقامهما، وفي الزروع، وفي أموال التجارة، وفي الأنعام، وأجمعوا على أن نصاب الذهب من كل 20 درهم درهم، من كل 20 دينار نصف دينار، ومن كل 200 درهم نصف درهم، وعلى أن نصاب التجارة كنصابها، وعلى نصاب الإبل خمس، وعلى نصاب الغنم، وهكذا. فمسائل العامة التي يحتاجها الذي يعبيها قوام الناس مجمع عليها، مجمع على اشتراط الطهارة، مجمع على كذا، لكن مختلف هل هذا الشيء ينقض الطهارة أو ما ينقض، هل مس الذكر أو مس، لكن الأشياء التامة أجمع أن البول ينقض الطهارة، وأن الريح ينقض الطهارة، وأن الغاط ينقض الطهارة، وأن النوم ينقض الطهارة، وأن إغاب العقل ينقض الطهارة، هذا مجمع عليه، وهذا ما يعم به البلوى. أما مسائل أخرى جانبية فهي المختلف عليها. ولذلك من ظن، وقال بعض الناس للأسف، أن مسائل الخلاف أكثر مسائل النص والإجماع، خطأ. قال الشيخ الإسلام مسائل النص والإجماع أكثر بكثير من المسائل المختلف فيها. ولذلك عامة المسائل التي يحتاجها الناس مما الخلل فيها، يقع الخلل فيه في العبادة وفي الدين، فإنها إما منصوص عليها أو مجمع عليها.
So the Sheikh said, and he began by mentioning the saying of the poet, in which he says that not each and every single type of difference of opinion is to be given your due care and attention, but rather only that where you can have some type of nazar, where you can actually go and research it further. So the meaning of this is that you don't just go and accept every type of difference of opinion, but only in those situations where you can go and further research the meaning of the ayah, or whether the hadith is to be accepted or not, and so on and so forth. And so the Sheikh then mentioned a very important point. And he said that this is an important principle to know, that the majority of things that we need to know, the majority of the matters of our religion, whether it is to do with fiqh, whether it is to do with aqidah, matters of belief, either they have clear texts or there is consensus upon them. And this is the overwhelming majority. And it is incorrect to think, as many people do, that the differences of opinion in Islam are more than those things which are agreed upon. This is something which many people now think, that the differences of opinion are so many that they greatly outnumber that which the scholars have agreed upon, that which there is a clear text regarding. And this is something which is completely incorrect. And the Sheikh said, take any example, and this is something that you will find. He gave the example of the prayer, that the prayer, all of the scholars have agreed, that there is an obligation upon every single person, that there are 5 prayers in a single day, that Fajr is 2 rak'ahs, Dhuhr is 4, Asr is 4, Maghrib is 3, Isha is 4. They have agreed that you need to be in a state of purification. They have agreed that you need to face the Qibla. They have agreed that you need to cover your awrah. They have agreed so many things. They have agreed that the time of the prayer needs to come in before you can pray. All of this is agreed upon. They have agreed, for example, that you go and you start with the Takbiratul Ihram, that you have to make ruku', that you have to come up from ruku', that you have to make sajda, that you sit between the 2 sajdas, that you make the tashahud. All of this is agreed upon. All of this is clearly stated. The only difference of opinion is in some small issues regarding on exactly how to perform this or how to do this. But the main picture, the main actions, all of this is agreed upon. Then he gave another example of zakah. This is also something which the scholars have agreed it is obligatory, that it is upon gold and silver and anything which takes the position and the place of gold and silver. They have agreed that it is also obligatory upon the people who have businesses, the people who have vegetation and livestock. All of this is something which is agreed upon. How much they need to pay, all of this is agreed upon. Rather, there is only some slight difference of opinion. Go back to the prayer again, or go back to purification. They have agreed what breaks your wudu. Whether it is, for example, urination or defecation or going to sleep or whatever it is, all of this is agreed upon. But there are only a number of small issues, such as whether you touch your private parts, whether this breaks wudu. These are the only small issues that the scholars have agreed upon. And this is what Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah also said, that those affairs, those issues that there is agreement upon, on which there is a clear text, they greatly outnumber and outweigh those positions or those issues on which there is a difference of opinion. And this is why you find that the majority of mistakes that people make, the majority of mistakes that they make is not based upon legitimate difference of opinion, but rather there is clear text in this regard and there is a clear unanimous decision on it.
وعلى هذا فمن الخطأ بمكان إذا علمنا هذا أن تقاس مسألة خلافية على مسألة إجماعية. يعني مثال ذلك يأتيك إنسان يقول لك يا أخي السلف العقيدة تأتي فرقة من الفرق وطائف من طوائف تتأول الصفات وتقول والله الضحك لا يوصف الله به وكذا ولا يجيء الله ولا ينزل وما شابه ذلك تقول يا أخي هذه فرقة مبتدعة قال يا أخي ليسعك الخلاف السلف اختلفوا في رؤية النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أقول اختلفوا في رؤية النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام لربه يوم القيامة وأجمعوا على إيش على هذا المسألة فأنت تأتي مسألة مختلف عليها تقيس على مسألة مجمع عليها كيف؟ ما يستقيم هذا نقول ما تريد أن يسمعوا الخلاف في مسألة مجمع عليها كيف نأتي تقول والله لأنهم اختلفوا في رؤية النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام ربي يوم في المعراج فنحن يجوز أن نختلف كيف؟ هم أجمعوا هنا واختلفوا هناك نقول هناك يسعنا أن تخالفنا لكن هنا لا يسعنا لأنها مسألة مجمع عليها فلا يقاس مسألة مختلف فيها على مسألة مجمع عليها كما يفعل بعض الناس اليوم يأتي للمسائل المنصوص عليها والمجمع عليها والتي سار عليها السلف ويريد أن يبيحها ونجعلها مسائل سائغة لأن السلف اختلفوا في كذا وكذا نقول اختلفوا في كذا وأجمعوا على كذا فهذه المسألة مجمع عليها فلا يمكنك أن تقيس على مسألة مختلفة فيها ولعل نختم بهذا والله أعلم وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وكما لك أسئلة بعد
طيب so the Sheikh concluded his lecture by saying that also from something which is a grave mistake and a grave error is that some people come and they take this analogy. They come to a mas'ala or an issue where the scholars had unanimous agreement. And then they say because they had unanimous agreement, or they come to an issue where there is a difference of opinion, and then they make an analogy using that with a mas'ala or an issue upon which there is an agreement. So for example, they will say concerning the Salaf that there will be a group of people who will come and they will hold the opinion that you don't take the names and attributes of Allah at face value. So for example, they will say that Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't laugh, that Allah Azza wa Jal doesn't descend to the lower heavens. They will have these opinions which are clearly wrong. And so you will say that this is something which is an innovation, it is clearly wrong. But someone will say to you, but the scholars of the past differed, the Salaf differed. So why don't you allow these people to also differ? For example, the scholars differed in the past as to whether or not the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Allah Azza wa Jal on Isra wal Mi'raj. The Shaykh said that this doesn't make any sense. It's not a balanced way of looking at things. Because that issue of the Prophet ﷺ seeing Allah in Isra and Mi'raj is an issue of which the scholars differed. But this issue that we're talking about the names and attributes of Allah, is an issue of consensus. So you can't use one and make an analogy of one upon the other. Rather, we say that in issues in which the Salaf differed, you can go and differ in those issues. But those issues in which there is a clear unanimous decision, a clear text from the Quran and Sunnah, you must follow that text. And it is not sufficient to say that the scholars used to differ in the past, so we can also differ today. And he said in conclusion that this is something which we often find today, that people make these types of incorrect analogies. And in that, inshallah, we're going to conclude. يقول السائل كيف يصلي المسافر The first question is how should the traveler pray
يقصر الرباعية ويجمع إن احتاج
The Shaykh said regarding the traveler of the prayer is that he shortens those prayers which are four rak'ahs so dhuhr, asr, isha he shortens them to two and if he needs to combine then he may do so The second question is, can the husband and wife pray together and how? هل يجوز للزوج والزوجة أن يصليا معا وكيف الطريقة؟
نعم يجوز الزوج والزوجة أن يصليا معا. فيصلي الزوج أمام الزوجة وقد تصف حذاءه لأنها زوجته وقد تصف وراءه. وكان هذا يفعله بعض السلف رحمهم الله وقد صلى النبي عليه وسلم بأم سليم وابن لها.
So the Sheikh said, yes, this is something which is permissible. And the way to do this is that the husband stands in front of his wife. And it may also be possible for her to stand next to him, but just slightly behind him. طيب يقول السائل الشيخ عندنا بعض الناس يرون عدم الجواز على لا يسلمون على أهل البدعة يرون تحريم هذا ويقولون أن السلف ما كانوا يسلمون على أهل البدعة فما رأيكم في هذا؟ The question is regarding those people who consider it impermissible, and I've obviously abbreviated the question, they consider it impermissible to give salams to non-Salafis or the people of Bid'ah. So what is your opinion on this?
ترك السلام على أهل البدع وهجرهم هذا باب العقوبة كما قال شيخ الإسلام فإن أهل البدع يهجرون لأمرين هجر من باب التقوى لأن الإنسان يخاف أن يقع في قلبه شيء من شبه هؤلاء فهو ترك ما يؤثر عليه وهجر من باب العقوبة حتى يرتدع هؤلاء ويرجع إلى السنة وقال شيخ الإسلام بأن الهجر إنما يشرع للمصلحة فإن كانت هناك مصلحة في هجر هؤلاء ويكون هجرهم سبيلاً لرجوع من السنة لا سيما في العصور التي ينتشر فيها السنة تنتشر فيها السنة فيصبح هذا الرجل إذا هجر لبدعته بعد ذلك أصبح إيش وحده منبوذاً فيكون سبيلاً لرجوعه كما كان السلف يهجره وقد لا يهجر إذا كانت المصلحة في عدم هجره لا سيما في أوقات الضعف إذا كان أهل السنة يعني قلة وأن أهل البدعة هي المنتشرة فإن هجر أهل السنة حينئذ لأهل البدعة بمعنى عدم السلام عليهم وغير ذلك ربما يحصرهم ولا تنتشر دعوتهم فالشاهد أن هذا تبع للمصلحة فالإنسان ينظر فإن كانت هناك مصلحة في هجر هذا الرجل وعدم السلام عليه فيعمل بها وإن كانت المصلحة في السلام عليه لعله يتألف قلبه ولعله يجد مجالا في أن يكلمه وينصحه ولعله يسمع منه ولعله يتخذها فرصة في أن يذكر له السنة والرجل قد يقبل منه فإنه يسلم عليه في سبيل الدعوة
الشيخ said that not giving salams to someone or boycotting someone this is done as a punishment for that person الشيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله mentioned that there are two primary reasons why you would boycott someone or not give them salams. The first of them is in order to restrain yourself or protect yourself. So for example, if you fear that if you go and sit with those people, you will be influenced by their thoughts, by their ideas, by what they do, then you stay away from them to protect yourself. And the second reason is you want to punish them. So you want to bring them back to the sunnah. You do it for the benefit of bringing them back to the sunnah. Or you know that if you leave them, you boycott them, this will be a punishment for them. And this will cause them to change in their ways. And the Shaykh said that this is exactly something that you would normally do at the times when the sunnah is strong. And the people of sunnah are strong. So if the people of sunnah boycott them and they are the minority, then they will obviously come back towards the sunnah because this will be a punishment for them. However, if the people of sunnah are weak, and the people of bid'ah and innovation, they are the majority, then this is something which you should not do because there will be no benefit of this. And so the Shaykh said, so for example, if you were to come across a person who's an innovator, and by giving him salams, you're able to go and sit with him and speak to him and give him da'wah and remind him of the sunnah and bring him back to the truth, then this is obviously something which is better in this situation and Allah knows best. يقول السائل للشباب الذين يريدون طلب العلم ما هي الخطوات الأولى لهم The question is for the youth who wish to seek knowledge what is the first thing that they should start with
أفضل الأمور الحقيقة لطلب العلم إن كان الإنسان يستطيع الالتحاق بالجامعات الإسلامية في الجامعة الإسلامية في المدينة في الرياض في غيرها من الجامعات أي جامعة إسلامية التحق بها والتحق بالعلماء فهذا هو أفضل سبيل وإن تعذر ذلك فهناك من الجامعات عبر الإنترنت جامعات السمة المفتوحة ومنها جامعة المدينة العالمية الجامعة على منهج الجامعة الإسلامية يرأسها الشيخ الدكتور محمد التميمي أحد السلفيين المعروفين، وهي جامعة في الحقيقة مفيدة جدا، ولها فرع الآن موجود في بريطانيا ابتدأت، فهذه يمكن الالتحاق بها لمن لا يستطيع الالتحاق بالجامعات الأخرى، ومنهجها كمنهج الجامعة الإسلامية. وأما من لم يستطع ذلك شيئا من ذلك فإنه يسعى جهده في الالتقاء بأهل العلم ويستفيد من طلبة العلم الموجودين في بلده أو في المكان الذي يعيش فيه بقدر استطاعته، مع الاستعانة بالأشرطة. الاستعانة بالأشرطة شروح العلماء لكثير من كتب الفقه والعقيدة وغير ذلك، الشيخ العثيمين والفوزان وغيرهم، شروحات كثيرة موجودة الآن عبر الإنترنت متوفرة. فيسعى الإنسان أن يتعلم، لكن إذا أراد العلم لا بد أن يتعلم اللغة العربية. لا تتصور يوما من الدهر، لا تتصور يوما من دهرك أنك يمكنك أن تصل إلى درجة علمية متأصلة وأنت لا تعرف اللغة العربية، هذا مستحيل. قد تعرف ثقافة تكون مثقف في الإسلام، أما أن يكون عندك علم موصل فلا بد من اللغة. وكان المسلمون عندما يفتحون البلدان أول ما يتعلم هؤلاء بعد الإسلام اللغة العربية. البخاري ليس بعربي، البخاري، ابن ماجه، مسلم، الترمذي، النسائي، كلهم ليسوا عربا، ولكنهم إيش؟ أول ما تعلموا اللغة العربية. ولذلك لا بد أن يتعلم اللغة العربية حتى يستطيع أن يفهم كلام الله، يفهم كلام رسوله عليه الصلاة والسلام، ويقرأ كتب العلم. فهذه بصورة مختصرة.
So the Sheikh said, obviously this is a very long and detailed question to be answered, but briefly, he said that he feels that the best option available is that you try to gain admission into Islamic universities, whether that be the Islamic University of Medina or the universities in Riyadh and the many other universities that there are. This is probably the best and most easiest way available. If that is not possible, then you get these universities that are done over the internet, these open kind of universities where you study over the internet and you study from your place. And he gave the example of a university which is known as Medina Alamiya. And this university is a university which takes the same methodology, the same syllabus as the Islamic University of Medina, and it spreads it over the internet. And this is under the presidency of Sheikh Muhammad al-Tamimi, one of the great scholars of Medina. And it's also a very beneficial university and a very beneficial way of seeking knowledge. And the Sheikh said that as far as he knows, there is now a branch also open in the UK as well of this university. If that is not possible as well, then what he would advise is that people go and they seek knowledge from the scholars that they have in their communities or the students of knowledge that they have access to. Go to them and seek knowledge from them. And as well as using cassettes and audio tapes and CDs, and they are widely available over the internet. You get many different explanations by Sheikh Saleh Fawzan, Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, and many of the great scholars. All of this is openly available on the internet. This is something which you're able to do. But then the Sheikh said it is important to know here. And don't ever imagine, ever, for a single day, that you will become a proper student of knowledge except through learning the Arabic language. This is something which is very, very important. If you don't know the Arabic language, then it may be possible that you have a bit of understanding, that you become a bit accustomed to some of the rulings of Islam, but you will never become a proper scholar or a proper student of knowledge without knowing the Arabic language first. And so this is why the Sheikh said that when the people used to go, when the Muslims used to go, and they would conquer other lands, the first thing that they would do is teach the people the Arabic language. So for example, you have Imam Bukhari, Imam Muslim, Imam al-Tirmidhi, al-Nasa'i, Ibn Majah. All of them were non-Arabs originally. They were from non-Arab lands. But they would learn the Arabic language. This was where the emphasis was placed. And then they became great scholars. So learn the Arabic language. This will allow you to understand the Quran. It will allow you to understand the Sunnah and the scholars and the works of the scholars of Islam. يقول السائل كيف ينزل الله سبحانه وتعالى إلى السماء الدنيا وهو الذي يدبر الكون. The question is how does Allah Azza wa Jal descend in this universe while He is the one who controls the universe.
إذا كان الله مثلي ومثلك يمكنك أن تسأل عن هذا. أما إذا كان الله جل وعلا لا يشابه شيء وليس كمثله شيء فهذا سؤال لا يذكر. لأن معرفة كيفية الصفة فرع عن معرفة الذات. فإذا كان الله جل وعلا لا نحيط علما بذاته جل وعلا فلا يمكن نحيط علما بصفاته. فلا تقس الله جل وعلا عليك. وهذا من الجهالات أن يقيس الإنسان ربه على صفاته هو، يقول كيف هو، لأنه يرى ذلك ممتنع على الإنسان فظن أن هذا لا يقوم بالله والله جل وعلا ليس كمثله شيء وهو السميع البصير.
The Sheikh said in response to this that if Allah Azza wa Jal was like me and you, then it is possible to ask this question and to be amazed at this. But Allah Azza wa Jal is unique and there is nothing like unto Him, Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. He is unique in every single way. And this is something which we cannot understand, it is something which we cannot comprehend. Because in order to comprehend this, you need to be able to comprehend Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala as well. And this is something which we don't have the ability to do. Allah Azza wa Jal is too great for us to comprehend Him. So this is why we are not able to comprehend how this happens. And the Shaykh said that from the biggest mistakes that you can make, from the ignorance that you can show, is that you think that Allah Azza wa Jal is like me and you, that He's like a human. Because we look at ourselves and we think that this is something impossible for us to do. So how is it then possible for Allah Azza wa Jal to accomplish? This is something which is incorrect, because Allah Azza wa Jal is unique and He is far greater and far better than all of the analogies that you can give to Him, and there is nothing like unto Him. The question that the brother is asking is, we mentioned that interpolating or giving a different interpretation to the names and the attributes of Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala is something which is a very dangerous affair. However, we see in history that scholars like Imam An-Nawawi and Ibn Hajar, they did something like this in their books as well. So how can we understand this? How can we reconcile between the two?
لمعرفة الجواب على هذا لابد أن نقول أمرين. أن رد بدعة إنسان ورد خطأه لا يعني أنك لا تستفيد منه في جانب آخر إن كان مجيدا فيه.
So the Shaykh said that in order to correctly respond to this question, we need to know two things, two affairs. Firstly, that just because you reject the mistake of someone or the innovation that he fell into, it doesn't mean that you cannot benefit from his other works or from other parts in which he is excels in and he is very good at.
ثم الذين خالفوا معتقد أهل السنة والجماعة كما ذكرت النووي وابن حجر والبيهقي وغيرهم هؤلاء من الأئمة الذين خدموا الإسلام وهؤلاء من العلماء الذين منهجهم ليس منهج أهل البدع وغيرهم فليس من أصول ابن حجر ولا النووي أن العقل يقدم على النقل ولذلك تجد ابن حجر في فتح الباري ربما وافق الأشاعرة وربما خالفه وكذا النووي إذا ذكر ذلك في شرح ماذا يقول؟ أنه يقول وقد اختلف العلماء في ذلك ولا يرجح وهذا محمول على ما كان شائعا في وقتهم من انتشار مذهب الأشاعرة فهم ساروا على ما ساروا عليه ولذلك لما جاء شيخ الإسلام وبين بأن هذا خلاف منهج السلف أصبح كالشاذ كالرجل يتكلم بأمر ما سمعوا بهم لا هم ولا آبائهم ولذلك هؤلاء ليس أصولهم أصول الأشاعرة أو الكلابية أو السالمية أو المعتزلة لا لكنه التبست عليه نتيجة تتلمذه على مشايخه التبست عليه هذه الأمور ومع ذلك ردت هذه الأمور نقول لا نقبلها منك لا نقبل من ابن حجر ولا من النووي ولا من البيهقي بل رد عليهم وغلف فيهم الكتب في بيان الأخطاء العقدية التي جاءت في ذلك لكن لما لهؤلاء من العلم الكثير والنفع العظيم ولما عرف عنهم من حسن القصد ولما لهم من البركة العظيمة في فنون العلم في الحديث وفي الرجال وفي الفقه وفي الأصول وفي غيرها قبل العلماء منهم ما أصابوا فيه وردوا ما أخطأوا فيه بخلاف الآخر الشخص الذي ليس له ما لابن حجر من الفضل والعلم والمكانة والمنزلة ولا لمثل النووي ولا لمثل البيهقي في نفع المسلمين وتأليف الكتب النافعة يأتي إنسان زيد وعبيد عام رجل لا يعرف بعلم ولا يعرف بشيء ولا يعرف بسنة ثم نقول أنت نعاملك كابن حجر خطأ كبير كيف نعاملك أنت كابن حجر هذا أمر الأمر الثاني أن ابن حجر أن الظن فيه أنه لم يعلم الحق وأن قصده الحق أما من يعيش اليوم مثلا وهو يسمع بالحق ويسمع بالأدلة فإن شيخ الإسلام ومحمد عبد الوهاب رحمه الله قد أوضحوا ذلك تم التوضيح ولذلك العلم اليوم انتشر أكثر بكثير من ذلك الوقت أي في سعة إيش في رد الشبهات وما شابه ذلك فلا يمكن نقيس في وقت ابن حجر النووي الذي الصورة العامة بل لا يكاد أحد كما قال الشيخ يسمع به مذهب السلف أصلا ولا يعرفه، يظنون أن مذهب السلف هو التفويض. كيف نعامل من عاش في ذلك الوقت ونفع الله به نفعا عظيما؟ ونقول حكم اليوم الذي يسمع بالحق ويرى الأدلة والبيان ويعاند ويكابن، نقول نعامله كابن حجر، كيف؟ خطأ. هذا أمر. الأمر الثاني أنه يفرق بين الأحياء والأموات. الرجل الذي مات ونفع الله به نفعا عظيما وخلف تركة عظيمة ولو أخطأ في بعض الأشياء ردت أخطاءه وقبل ما فيه من العلم لبركة علمه، يختلف عن الشخص الذي هو حي الآن. لو رضيت عنه هو رجل الآن داعي لبدعته، داعي لضلالته، داعي لخطئه، كيف أقبل منه؟ ابن حجر قد مات، قلنا يا جماعة ابن حجر أخطأ في كذا وكذا وكذا، لا تأخذوا منه كذا، خذوا منه كذا. أما هذا الرجل لو سكتنا عنه وهو ينشر بدعته، هذا نشر للضلالة. فلا يمكن نساوي بين الحي وبين الميت، بين العالم وبين إيش؟ غير العالم، بين من لم يتوصل له الحق ومن توصل له الحق، هناك فروق كبيرة، ولذلك هذه موازين لا بد أن نعلمها.
So the Sheikh said that it is important to know first and foremost that these people, the likes of Imam al-Nawawi, the likes of Ibn Hajar rahimahumullah and others, were from the great scholars of Islam. And their manhaj, their methodology was the methodology of the Salaf. It wasn't the methodology of the people of Bid'ah. This isn't something which was the methodology that they were upon. Rather, for example, they would never say that the intellect has more precedence over the texts of the book and the sunnah. But rather they may have mentioned some of these opinions, and sometimes they agree with these opinions of the innovators and sometimes they disagree with them. Like for example, the opinions of the Asha'ira. Sometimes they agree with them and sometimes they disagree with them. And the Shaykh said that the reason for this, the reason for them falling into these mistakes, was because the madhab of the Asha'ira during that time was the most prevalent madhab. Everyone was upon this. And it was very rare for someone to be other than this. So this was something which they took from their society, from their community, from the teachers that they studied under, and this was something which was then portrayed in their books. And so it is important to know this, because Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah mentions this, that the situation that they lived in, the society that they lived in, was a society that didn't know anything other than that which they were upon. And this is why when Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah came later on, and he began to spread the methodology of the Salaf, it was something which was considered rare. It was something which was considered strange because the people had not heard of it for a very long time. So we say concerning these scholars that we know about their knowledge, we know about the benefit that they gave to Islam, we know about the blessings that their knowledge has, we know about the good intentions that they possessed, we know about all of this. So this is why the scholars took from them that which was correct. And they refuted their mistakes and they said that these were mistakes that they fall in and this is something which we reject. And the scholars have written works upon this, the mistakes that they made and how they fell into them and how we should disagree with those mistakes. The Shaykh said that this is completely different to someone who doesn't have this virtue and status in Islam. He doesn't have this knowledge. He hasn't written all these works. He hasn't done this service to Islam. How can now we come to and say to this man, you're like Ibn Hajar and we're going to treat you like Ibn Hajar? This is incorrect. This isn't how we deal with people. Rather, we know that these scholars of Islam, they wanted the truth. They wanted the truth, but for one reason or another, they weren't able to reach it. Whereas someone who is living today, and he hears the truth, and the evidences and proofs are brought to him, but then he still continues upon his way, how can we now say that you are like Ibn Hajar or the likes of Al-Imam al-Nawawi? And the Shaykh then continued also and he said that there is also an essential difference here between those who have passed away and those who are still living today. Those scholars, the likes of Ibn Hajar and Nawawi, they have passed away. And so the scholars have mentioned the good that they did and they mentioned that the mistakes that they fell in as well. This isn't like someone who's still living today, who comes across the truth but he still continues upon his falsehood. How can we say he's like Ibn Hajar and then remain quiet? Because that man, if we remain quiet, he will continue to spread his innovation. No, rather we need to speak out because there is a difference of here, a clear difference. We can't treat the one who is a scholar like the one who is ignorant. We can't treat the one who wants the truth like the one who stays away from the truth.
يقول السائل ذكرت يا شيخ أن الخروج على الأمة أمر منهي عنه وأمر حرام، فهل هذه قاعدة عامة ينطبق على جميع الحكام أو هل هو شيء يستثنى منه الظالم الطاغية الذي لا يحكم بشرع الله؟
هذا قاعدة عامة. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال في الحديث، حديث عبادة بن الصامت عليكم السمع والطاعة في منشطكم ومكرهكم وعسركم ويسركم إلا أن تروا كفرا بواحا عندكم فيه من الله برهان. لم يستثني النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام إلا الكفر، واشترط أن يكون بواح وأن يكون الدليل عليه من كتاب الله تبارك وتعالى، أي مجمع عليه. فقوله إلا أن تروا كفرا بواحا دل على أن ما ليس بكفر ولو كان ظلما عظيما فإنه لا يجوز خروج عليه. ابن الحجاج قتل العلماء، يعني تصوروا إنسان يأتي حاكم يقول أين علماء البلد؟ قالوا فلان وفلان. أين طلبة العلم؟ أتى بطلبة العلم والعلماء وقتلهم، قطع رؤوسهم. لا شك أن هذا أمر عظيم جدا، ومع ذلك لم يجوز الخروج عليه. فالقضية طالما أنه لم يصل لحد الكفر المجمع عليه فلا يجوز الخروج عليه. ولذلك النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام وصف في حديث مسلم قال سيكون عليكم ولاه قلوبهم قلوب الشياطين في جثمان إنس. تصور أنت الآن حاكم قلبه قلب شيطان وجسمه الظاهر جسم إنس. قال صلى الله فما تأمرنا؟ قال اسمع وأطع وانظري وظهرك وأخذ مالك. فالأحاديث متضافرة في هذا مجمع عليها. أما ما صدر من الحكام مما يكون كفرا كسب الدين والاستهزاء أو قلب عدم صلاحيته أو يعتنق أمر النيش مخالفا أو يرد أمرا مظاهرا فهذا، ولكن نقول نحن الحاكم إن لم يظهر منه الكفر فلا يجوز خروج عليه، وإن ظهر منه الكفر فإنه لا يخرج عليه إلا إذا كانت هناك قدرة على إزالته من غير ضرر. الله أعلم.
So the Sheikh said in response to this question that this is a general principle that we apply to everyone. If they are people who are, even if they are oppressive or transgressive and unjust, this is something which we apply to everyone. And he mentioned the hadith of Ibad ibn Sariyah where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that it is upon you to listen and to obey at times of ease and at times of difficulty. And then he said, except if you see from them a type of disbelief which is open and apparent and you have a clear established text regarding it. So the Sheikh said, even if they do whatever they do, even if they are oppressive and unjust and they do as much as they want to do, and they're from the greatest tyrants of the earth, so long as they don't do anything which is considered disbelief, which is apparent and clear, which the scholars agree upon, which there is unanimous consensus upon, it is not allowed for you to revolt against them. And he gave an excellent example here of Al-Hajjaj. Al-Hajjaj ibn Yusuf was someone who killed many of the scholars and many of the students of knowledge. The Sheikh said he would go to a land and he would say, so the Sheikh said that he would go to a land and he would say to the ruler of that land, where are your scholars? Where are the students of knowledge? And they would all be gathered and he would chop off all of their heads. And the Sheikh just said, now that in Iraq he killed over 4,000 scholars. He's saying, imagine someone who did this. But at the same time, the scholars wouldn't allow to go and revolt against him. It wasn't someone that was revolted against so long as he doesn't reach that level of disbelief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he mentioned also the hadith in Sahih Muslim where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that you will find that there will come a time upon you when your rulers will have the hearts of devils within the bodies of men. Imagine this. They will have the hearts of devils and they will be in the bodies of men. This is how evil they will be. So the companion said, O Messenger of Allah, what do you order us with? So the Prophet ﷺ replied, listen to them and obey them, even if they strike your backs and steal your wealth. Continue to listen and obey them. So the Shaykh said, unless you see some type of clear type of disbelief and you are able to correct this disbelief or you are able to do something, this is when you should take action. Otherwise, it is not allowed for you to do so. And inshallah, with that, we're going to conclude. We'd like to thank our Sheikh Faisal Al Jasim as well as all of you.